Hello, everyone. I'm John Evans, and welcome to another episode of One on One. Many cities in North Carolina have rich histories. Few, if any, can match Wilmington's history and contribution to World War II. Wilbur Jones lived in this city during that wartime, and he has spent decades of his life researching it and helping to preserve it. Seven of the 18 books Wilbur Jones has written deal with Wilmington's history during World War II. And now he's leading the effort to bring a very special designation to his hometown, to have it named the first American World War II heritage city. What is your earliest memory of World War II?
December 7, 1941. I have very vivid memories to this day of exactly where I was and what I was doing when I heard the news about the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor.
What were you doing?
I was in the sunroom of my home in Forest Hills, 102 Colonial Drive, and I was listening to the Washington Redskins Philadelphia Eagles football game, which had just gotten started in D.C.
1 o'clock Eastern time.
Yes, right? It was. And as a matter of fact, the correct time in Wilmington when the first attack started was 1:20 p.m. because of different time zones, and we had gone on the East Coast on some kind of preparatory wartime time. Anyway, I was listening to the game messing around my son parlor when I heard the news. And, of course, I had no idea what was happening. I can remember that we knew that the world was at war. I was 7 years old, and it was... I went to my parents, what's going on, and we went from there.
Do you remember how things changed after that day, or did it take you maybe a couple of years to see the change in everyday life in this country and how America was after that attack?
It changed immediately, John, because the very next day, and I certainly, this was borne out in the research I've done for my books and all of my things I have written and appearances I've made. Anyway, it happened the very next day because it was the attack was on Sunday, and the first Wilmington Star News edition that came out that day, and it was the Sunday Star News, the entire front page was all about the launching of the first Liberty ship at our Wilmington shipyard, the Zebulon B. Vance. And then our small paper in a small town published two other editions, two extras. And so the news of the ship launching moved down the page on the front and bled over to the second page. And then on the third edition of the day, believe it or not, the ship launching was off the front page, all on the second page, and it was all war. And we heard this at school. When we got to school the next day, we could see things happening in our community. The boys were going away, and fathers and sons. It was an immediate impact.
Did it change you in a way that, had it not have happened, would you have gone into the Navy? Or I mean, you were only seven, so I'm not saying, you know, it was a transformation at that age, but, you know, when you were younger, service to the country was a given thing. Most men did it.
Yes, you're right.
But did it change the way you perceived it? Did you want to go and serve after that happened?
Oh, yes. My whole life for those 4 years of the war between ages 7 and 11, it was all-encompassing, the war, and because we didn't have the media anywhere near, obviously, the media that would distract us from things. We went to Forest Hill School and we studied, but everything was connected to the war. We played war games all through Forest Hills and the Oleander area. And to get back to the thrust of your question, I guess I was headed down just a one-way street. I could see both sides, but I became very interested in the armed forces, and my father had been in the Navy in World War I, and it was the thing to do in those days, not only for my generation, but for the boys who went away to war. And so I was a writer at a very early age. Right. I love to research and study. I started collecting things. You should see my World War II boyhood memorabilia that my mother and I collected, which I exhibit every once in a while. And I don't think that I really had an opportunity to do anything else other than serve my country and in starting with the Navy.
You were 15 years old, I think, when you actually started as a part-time writer at the Star News.
Yes. Can you imagine that happening today?
No.
I was very fortunate because I had loved to write. I'd been editor of, and was editor at that time of the Wildcat, the newspaper at New Hanover High School. And I was encouraged to. My father knew the publisher and said, can you take him on for part-time? And I started working part-time and then had the opportunity to continue there for 3 years, summer and after school.
Did you ever think about journalism reporting as a career? I know you went into and did some PR at some point, but you went into the Navy and really kind of took naval service, and then we're going to get into some of your political jobs, but you really served in the DOD and the Navy, which became your career. Was media or journalism at any point in time a possibility?
Originally it was, yes. Good question. Because of my activity, writing activity, and being an editor at the Wildcat newspaper, and then at the Star News, I went to Carolina to study journalism because they had a great journalism school, still do, and that was, I wanted to be a sports writer because I was a sports nut, as well as, I've been a nut about a lot of things in my life, and that was a combination of sports and military and such. But after I entered the general college before I went into my degree courses, and decided after my sophomore year that you'll get a kick out of this, that there just wasn't enough money in as a sports writer in sports journalism.
That hasn't changed.
I know my son Andrew has been, he's the dean of North Carolina sports writers now, covering the ACC 24 years, and he tells me the same thing.
Yeah.
But I changed my degree over to history, and it really was a brilliant move. Yeah, brilliant move.
You know, when you got into the Navy and some of the service, you got into it, and you were 14 years active and then reserves, correct? Where did you serve? And tell me about some of your trips and some of the fond memories.
Well, I did serve 14 years on active duty and then 14 years in the Ready Reserve. I was regular Navy for a while. I was on 6 different ships: destroyers, service force, and amphibious force ships. And I pulled a tour in the Pentagon. In fact, I ended up both as a civilian assistant to the Undersecretary of Defense and as a Navy captain in the Office of Chief of Naval Operations. I served my time in purgatory in the Pentagon.
Yeah.
7.5 years. It's a long walk from the office out to the parking lot when there's 6 inches of snow out there.
Sure.
But I had some wonderful experiences with deployments from California out to the Far East. Saw some places I'd would never imagine. I'm a little boy from Wilmington, and I'm in a taxi cab holding on for dear life, driving through the streets of Tokyo without stoplights. The only thing the driver has is his horn, you know, that kind of thing. And then I had duty in the Mediterranean on a couple of ships, and that's where I met my future wife, Carol, of 54 years there in Italy.
Mm-hmm.
So I've had some wonderful experiences. And in fact, the time in the Pentagon was exceptionally good service. I had a very responsible job when I was on active duty. And then when I was assigned as an assistant to the undersecretary, the number 3 guy in the Pentagon, I was given a lot of responsibility. So I felt very good about my career in the Navy.
And how did you get, excuse me, but how did you get hooked up with Mr. Goldwater? Because weren't you kind of an assistant to him at some point in time, or you were on his campaign in 64?
Yeah, 64. I was on active duty at Coronado at the amphibious base, California. And I had submitted my papers to resign regular Navy commission to go into the reserve, and after 9 years, and I became very interested in politics and the conservative movement. Goldwater was not the father of it, but he was the most
the face of it.
The face of it. And I started reading books on conservatism, and I didn't like what was going on in the country. So I'm going to confess to you, you'll be the first, this first time I will ever have confessed this publicly to your listeners, and I violated the Hatch Act.
Uh-oh.
Yep. but I think it's expired, whatever.
Yeah.
But I was on active duty and volunteered in San Diego for Senator Goldwater's campaign, and started at the very bottom doing the usual kind of trite things, you know, mm-hmm. licking stamps and all that. And when I got out of the Navy and moved to Los Angeles, I got very heavily involved in politics. And in those days, it was very easy to move up in the Republican Party in California because the Goldwater debacle, you know, lots of pieces fell apart. So I was in the right place at the right time. And ended up working for the party organization in L.A. County. Did a very good job in helping to elect Ronald Reagan as governor in 1966. And I was able to use that to work as the chief of staff for a congressman from the district around Burbank and Antelope Valley and San Fernando Valley. I worked for him for a couple of years. Then he became lieutenant governor under Reagan, opened up the seat. So guess who comes along and decides to run? Senator Goldwater's son, Barry.
Right.
So this was 5 years later, and I had the chance to repay him. He asked me to come on and be his personal assistant, essentially the campaign manager on wheels. And so I knew the district and got him elected. He brought me back to Washington. I set up his office in the House of Representatives. And the promise was that if I do this for you, Barry, you and your father will help get me a job downtown. That's what it was called, you know, right. Down Pennsylvania Avenue.
Yeah.
And they worked down.
And that was with, you became kind of the advance person for President Ford then, correct? How did you meet him or get on that?
Another story of first of all, keeping my nose clean and looking over my shoulders and keeping alert and doing a good job. I had a political appointments as assistants in the General Services Administration. And the Nixon White House asked me to join in training to become an advance man for President Nixon with the 1972 election on the horizon. And I agreed, and because I had some solid on-the-ground political experience. So I went through training and maintained all the right contacts, and I had known Bob Haldeman and John Ehrlichman of Watergate fame when we were in California together, and I knew a lot of the Nixon people. So when I didn't get called up, but that's another story about how I almost skated, and I was in a position, crazy enough, sort of a roundabout way, to get sucked into the Watergate scandal. Thank God I didn't.
And I'm basically saying it didn't happen, or you could have been in a much different path along the way.
Well, if it was going to happen, I hypothetically could have been the guy across the street from the Watergate Hotel looking as the lookout. because this is crazy. It's all in my memoir, which I've just finished, by the way.
I know you were telling me. That's why I wanted to call you in here.
Yeah. And crazy story, but to the point, I turned down an opportunity to advance Attorney General John Mitchell's wife to Florida. She was causing a lot of problems. She drank a lot. They need to get her out of town, dry her out. So they said, Jones, how about taking Martha Mitchell down to Florida for a week and see what the sunshine does? And but between my boss and myself, then, oh, that's too political. See, I couldn't do political stuff. It was all government stuff. And no, better not do it. And I said, okay, please don't send me. I don't want to go. Turns out that the guy who took that role was a fellow named Baldwin, who became the lookout. That was one of his next assignments.
Drafted to be as a part of history.
Yeah. It's sort of clever. I would never have accepted any position that would have involved in Watergate, but I like to talk about the hypothetical connection.
And President Ford, as you got to become an advanced man for him, what can you share about the man that you knew as President Gerald Ford?
Well, of course, when Nixon resigned in late 1974, and Ford was vice president, had not been elected, he had been appointed, and he became president. And the core of the Nixon advance team was sort of wiped out, pushed aside. Nixon's way of operating and his staff's way of operating was what you have heard, because you are very perceptive mm-hmm. about the history of politics. And Ford wanted a completely different team. We kept some of the guys around, but he wanted people that were more like his style and not Nixon's style. Turns out that I did 49 advances for Ford. And both in town, I did virtually all his military-associated events because I was a Naval Reserve officer. And overseas events, and I had some wonderful experiences. I had an enormous amount of responsibility that an advance man has as the personal representative of the president. And I marvel today because when I look at President Trump, President Obama, President Bush, and where they are and how they're staged in events, and I think about the advance man, what he's gone through and the potential for screwing up and having a media catastrophe or anything. But fortunately, I didn't have any of those, except a couple of funny things that are in my memoir. They're really crazy. I'll just tell you one of them.
Well, yeah, if it's making you laugh this much, you've got to at least share one of them.
Well, okay, there was one about the Oklahoma University football helmet that Ford tried to put on. Oh, gosh, in front of 25,000 people. Oh, that was my job.
And he tried to put it on?
Yeah, because Ford and I were the same size. Uh-huh. We were 6'1", about 185 pounds. And it was easy for me because the president gets a lot of stuff, Philadelphia Flyers hockey shirts and baseball caps and Indian war bonnets, headdresses. Mm-hmm. And I always check things out as the advance man. And Oklahoma, we were in Lawton, Oklahoma, 25,000 people at the airport. Believe me, crazy. And Heisman Trophy winner from OU wanted to get the president an OU football helmet. I said, okay, I was in a hurry. I said, just go ahead. I gave it to the Secret Service because they always had to check it out. But I didn't put it on. You see what I'm saying, John? Okay, he puts it on. He loved to put things on. He's tugging on it. It ain't going anywhere. He's tugging on it again. And it doesn't fit. And I'm thinking, oh, Lord, please. That photograph made Newsweek, Time, the Atlanta Journal-Constitution, the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, every local newspaper. I was devastated. And
what did he say to you?
And, of course, the media even then was a little, you know, left of center, shall we say. He didn't say anything, but we had an overnight in Lawton, Oklahoma, and we hated the overnights because we had to put the president to bed. And after I did that, I escorted him up to his room in the hotel. I went back down and joined Dick Cheney, who was our chief of staff, mm-hmm. and some guys at the bar. I remember Cheney said something to him about laughing. He said, "You like that football helmet?" I was, "Oh my God!" And that was it. I know.
Would you have been able to do that job in today's media crush and be able to do the same kind of thing? Or can you imagine doing that job now in the day of today's social media and network media and cable news?
It would be a whole different ball game. Because, and number one, the technology involved, and you just mentioned some of the media. And in our day, we had a walkie-talkie radio, and on the days of the events, we had earplugs and that sort of thing, carried it on our belt. We had a fax machine and a telephone in our office, and that was it.
Yeah.
Fax machine. We would hand-draw illustrated diagrams to send back to the White House by fax, showing the president all of his movements and who he was going to meet, who'd be sitting up on the podium with him. And I would be out there getting all the intelligence and the recon and sending it back. But it was all done by hand. And I in writing my memoir, I spent a couple of months out at Randall Library at UNCW, where my personal papers right. collection is. And refreshed my mind on all of this stuff. How in the world we do it? So the short answer to your question, I don't see how they do it now, but I wish they'd take me along for old time's sake. I would love to go and see how it's done now.
So you spend, you know, decades in the Navy and you finally retire as a captain. Why come back to Wilmington? What prompted the decision to come back here? I guess it was in 97 you moved back
here?
Yes,
I did.
You and your wife?
Yes, my wife, and we were raising our only grandchild, Carrie, whom we raised since, had custody of since she was two. And we just wanted to get away from Washington. And Carol loved to come here because we would come about every summer and visit the beach and so on. So we had kept tabs on Wilmington. And as she said, she convinced me, she said, "Wilbur, this is your hometown. This is your people." And I said, "You know what I do? One reason I want to go back is because I want to see what they're doing to preserve World War II history, and I want to write a book." And it turned out that I ended up writing two books and sort of, as you know, taking the lead on preserving our wonderful World War II history. So that's the main reason I came back. But I didn't stop working. All I did was just shift my office.
Right. But it's amazing to me, and I've told you this tons of times, how much I respect you for doing the research that went into the books that you've written and your dedication to the World War II effort here and the research. But, you know, you were a history major, and you like World War II history. You grew up in it. But was there a specific incident that got you onto the want to write a book and want to do historical research? Did you read something that you knew wasn't right and wanted to right a wrong? I'm just kind of curious as to what set it off.
Well, I had started writing books for the Defense Department and the Government Printing Office on national defense when I was still working. I was 12 years on the faculty of the Defense Acquisition University at Fort Belvoir, and that was one of my jobs. So I wanted to continue writing. I knew that no one had written a book about wartime Wilmington. And when I came back, my reputation advanced to me, and I asked around. No one had done this, and I was in the position when I was asked to head a group in 1998-1999 on wartime Wilmington commemoration. Mm-hmm. And that was a huge event of 125 different events and activities. And all of a sudden, the mantle just fell on me. And I was glad to do it. And I wrote the two books. And I've given, since I've been here in over 20 years, well over 700 interviews, lectures, presentations. And I've been in national media. All on behalf of Wilmington, mm-hmm. not on behalf of Wilbur, because mm-hmm. in our effort to get the World War II city recognition, national recognition, I don't get anything out of it other than the wonderful pride of having my hometown where I grew up during the war recognized for what we did during the war and then what we have done since then to preserve it.
What amazes you about Wilmington in World War II? What amazes you about the effort of this entire city toward that World War II effort?
Well, it all centered around the shipyard, of course, and the shipyard was the biggest employer in the state. Our population just about tripled. No one knows how many, but I use around 100,000 because we had so many transients. We had all five of the armed services here. We had our two Medal of Honor recipients from New Hanover High School. As far as we know, that's the only high school in the country with two from World War II Medal of Honor recipients. All of the factories and industry that was producing, the railroad, the Atlantic Coast Line Railroad and such, that's what we did during the war. And Wilmington was a boomtown. I mean, after the war, the shipyard closed, the jobs went away. The boys came home from the war, but there were no jobs, and there was nothing. Wilmington went into that malaise period, which you well remember. You came in at the tail end of the malaise, mm-hmm. and until the around 1970. And during this time, when Wilmington started urban renewal and tearing down a lot of historic places, particularly downtown, I had learned about that, and I knew what was happening. And when I came to Wilmington the first day in 1997, I heard on the radio that the city was going to tear down the community arts center. Yeah. And it was going to be a parking lot for the St. John's Museum across the street. And I joined immediately with Hannah Block and the Thalian Association and others to stop that. And we went to the city council. The long story short is that since then, we've gotten 100% support from council and staff. And we have a wonderful World War II memorial to our county dead, to our Medal of Honor recipients. It's a mini museum of the home front. But most of all, it's a perfect blending of the art and history.
Did anything that you, while you were uncovering for any of your books, did anything just absolutely shock you about what happened during the war effort here as you uncovered pieces of history, as you heard stories being told? You know, there's the one about the German U-boat off the coast that supposedly fired mortars onto the chemical factory near Fort Fisher. Did anything like that or any fact that you uncovered say, I can't believe this happened, but here it is?
Well, you just hit on probably the most illustrative point. And the fact, and I consider it a fact, that a German U-boat did fire on the Etherdal chemical plant at Curie Beach in 1943. And yes, we did have saboteurs who came ashore, and I've talked to eyewitnesses, and it's in my books. And of course, that didn't appear until after the war, because we didn't know about that. I mean, the government didn't tell us all of what was going on, all the ships being sunk off North Carolina coast.
And nobody tweeted it out or put it on Facebook
exactly.
or had pictures of it.
Thank goodness. But two things did, and good questions of my, from my perspective, I had forgotten that we were so segregated in that town at that time, and the way that the whites and the blacks were separated from almost absolutely everything we did. And the other thing was the amount of crime that we had here, which I uncovered during my research, and murders and rapes and fornication and thefts, and the fact that the FBI at the end of the war said for a city of its size, Wilmington has the highest crime rate per capita. And that's all in my book. Wilmington was Sin City, and I lived in Forest Hills. And at that time, it was upper middle class. And my father worked downtown. I came down with him. I came to the USO. I went over to the shipyard. And we had people that worked for him who were black. But, I mean, I'm young. I don't know what's going on. But, yes, those are three things that jumped out at me in my research.
Was any of your books more difficult to write than any other?
Of the books I've written?
Yeah.
Yeah. I just finished my memoir. Try it sometime. And you will.
Mine's going to be a paragraph and a half.
No, it won't either, John Evans. After 35 years in this business, you've got at least another 10 or 15, at least. Getting started, my children had told me for years, Dad, you've written all these books about other people. You know, why don't you write one about yourself? I said, well, I'm going to have to do it myself, because there is a difference between a memoir and a biography. Mm-hmm. And I could write your biography, but I couldn't write your memoir. And in the prologue to my memoir draft, I say that the difference is that in my memoir, I will tell you only what I want you to know. So, and if you're looking for deep, dark secrets,
you got to get the unauthorized biography.
Get the unauthorized version after I'm dead and gone. But I had put it off for some time, and when I finished the book about Carol and her parents, based on her mother and a wonderful career she had as a photographer a couple of years
ago. That's a fantastic tribute to Carol, too. But it's a great story on top of being a great tribute.
What a wonderful family they were. And I had been putting it off. I'd written 18 books, and I put it off. And I've been working on other World War II history. But I finally decided to do it. And essentially, in the first 4 months of this year, I wrote my memoir. And I have a very good agent and editor, John Meyer, and we're working now to polish it up. And let's see where it goes. If I end up having to publish it myself, I don't care. I think everyone will really enjoy reading it, even if they don't like me, if they can just take the name of the author associated with it, put it out of the way, and just read about somebody's life who's done all these things. Mm-hmm. I mean, we haven't even talked about my career as a professional basketball official and baseball umpire.
I was going to get to that a little bit because, I mean, you know, here you are for the longest time. You dug up history and you know, you're talking and you're serving your country, and then all of a sudden, why on God's green earth you would want to put on a striped shirt and go try to remain calm in the chaos of professional sports or amateur sports? I'll never know. Why'd you do that for?
Well, like lots of fathers, attending their kids' Little League games, when the umpire doesn't show up, you get drafted, kicking and screaming, you know, out to umpire, that sort of thing. But I'm a very decisive person. I love challenges. I'm not a meals on wheels guy. I want to be the guy who puts together the meals on wheels. Mm-hmm. And I like leadership positions, and that evolved out of World War II and certainly out of my Navy career and my sports career at Carolina. I played two varsity sports, contact sports at Carolina. So I look for leadership roles because I know if I'm going to do it, it'll work.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, but that's, you know, at my age, I'm free to say that.
But you know, no, and you shouldn't ever have to, you know, have to defend a decision like that. The thing to me is that, you know, And again, I'm going to start from maybe where you played sports in the 50s. There was probably a little bit more respect for the guys who wore the striped shirts and blew the whistles. This day and age, they get creamed on social media. So again, it would be different doing it now than it was maybe in the years where you started doing it.
Yes, it was very different. And of course, I started in a local little league, and that's the best test bed because you have to put up with your neighbors who are screaming and yelling at you. Especially, you know, when you've been there.
I remember. Yeah. I still one of the memories I have of Little League is being in a dugout and one of the parents coming over and just yelling at the umpire and the umpire grabbing a bat and threatening to hit the parent with it. But, you know, putting it back down and going back out. And I'm sitting down here, you know, 8 or 9 years old saying, what is this? Not supposed to be a contact sport. We're playing baseball here.
Unfortunately, I'm glad I wasn't in your neighborhood.
It's so funny how that comes back into your mind. The one question I wanted to ask you and talk about was Ben Kingsley, Sir Ben Kingsley. Mm-hmm. You had the opportunity to give him a personalized tour of the battleship North Carolina.
Yes.
How did that come about, and what is your memory of that? That had to have been just a treat to do.
Yes, it was, and I'm glad you reminded me of that because Captain Terry Bragg, the executive director of the battleship, was approached by Sir Ben, I guess it's been about 5 years ago now, mm-hmm. and because he was coming off of doing Iron Man 3 and here and wanted... he was going to do a movie about, I think, the Battle of Jutland in World War One, Naval Battle of Jutland in World War One, and he wanted to see what the ship looked like. So Terry, and of course I've been very active with the battleship and on the commission, Terry asked me to join him, and we gave him a long tour one afternoon. And answered a lot of questions. He had one aide with him. Very nice guy. We really enjoyed it, and it was certainly worth it from our standpoint.
But that's one of those things, though, that you don't plan on. You know, life kind of taps you on the shoulder and says, you're going to spend a couple of hours with an Academy Award winner, mm-hmm. and you're going to answer his questions, and you're going to be the expert, and he's going to come here to talk to you. It's funny how life just takes those little side roads.
It does, and I think we were able to help him because Terry knows where every bolt and rivet is on the battleship, so he could provide that. And then I could provide, I knew a little bit about World War One history as well, so I could tell him about the Pacific War and the battleship North Carolina. And I think we helped him. And interestingly enough, I asked Terry a couple of times subsequent to that, I said, did you ever get a thank you letter or a note from mm-hmm. Sir Ben? He said, nope, never heard from him.
Oh, unfortunate.
What a shame.
Yeah.
But it was a lot of fun doing it.
What do you do for fun? I know you work out. I know you're a physical fitness nut. But what do you do for fun? Or is history fun to you?
John, you know me better than anybody in town, I think, when you say that. I will continue to work, and I enjoy my work because my work is doing something for other people. And I do enjoy helping others. Families of World War II veterans who have memorabilia, what do I do with it? I don't want to throw it away. They come to me. And in my presentations, in the things I write, and my appearances, I am preserving World War II history for the state of North Carolina and working with Senator Tillis and Senator Burr and Congressman Rouser for the state, for Wilmington and New Hanover County. And that's what I thoroughly enjoy. But my relaxation is I enjoy French and Italian wines and popcorn and beer. But when I watch television with my dear lady friend Anne LaRue, mm-hmm. We watch the BBC, the History Channel, Smithsonian, National Geo. See, we're highbrow.
But you're still learning.
And we don't watch Channel 6 at night. Watch the news from Channel 6.
But you can get us on Roku. We know you don't have to watch us live. But the key is that you still continue to learn. Smithsonian, History Channel, some of these things. Those are opportunities to continue to learn.
Yes.
And maybe today you know something you didn't know yesterday.
Exactly.
And that's fulfilling to you now, even after all these years of doing it.
I think that the one reason that I feel so good at my age is because I've kept my feet moving and my brain cells working, and I continue to learn. I read a lot. I read constantly, too, when I'm not watching Smithsonian and such. And never a dull moment. I go nowhere without taking magazines to read if I have to wait in line. I'm that kind of person. I guess you could say I'm an A personality. Some people may think that I'm an introvert if I'm not a small talker at parties, but I'm thinking serious things, like
when. And I'm trying to shape this question. I've been thinking about it since we talked on this past Saturday. And for those of you out there who didn't see the very classy shorts that I wore to an event on Saturday that my wife picked out, that Wilbur gave me nothing but flack over for an hour and a half at a charity event.
It was not flack. It was friendly flack. Friendly fire, yeah.
But I've been thinking about it ever since we had that conversation is, why do people forget about history until it's brought up by somebody else? And when I say that is, you write a book about Wilmington's history, and all of a sudden people want to learn about it. You write a book about your wife's family, about the history of that, and then all of a sudden people want to learn about it. People really don't have a care for history unless somebody gives them, like you, a willingness to want to learn.
And they have to stop and realize, oh boy, I better look at this. And I think the reason is because every generation is out trying to outpace the previous generation. And goodness knows today's generation is, with all of the access we have to media, social mm-hmm. media. Mm-hmm. And I think Americans today, and even Europe, I go to Europe all the time, and thoroughly love Europe. They're the same way we are. It's not what's happened. It's not necessarily what's happening now. It's what's going to happen next. And they're always looking ahead, what's going to next. What can happen to them? How can they influence something? So as a result, yesterday becomes yesterday, mm-hmm. and the day before that becomes ancient history. And people aren't necessarily looking back unless they're holding a grudge and saying, you know, you did something to me. But other than that, I think people are so preoccupied with what they're doing now, what's in it for them, and what they and what they're going to have to do tomorrow.
How long does it take you to write a book?
Well, I just the memoir I just finished is about 55,000 words, and
but I meant some of your other ones, like if you had an idea.
Yeah, it depends on that. When I wrote my most popular book, Gyrene, the World War II United States Marine, which the Marine Corps gave me a nice grant to start writing at the 50th anniversary of the war. It took me several years because I went with the Marines to a lot of their battlefields in the Pacific. I went to a lot of their reunions, to doing research. You know, I interviewed thousands of them. So that book, and I really talk about starting with a blank piece of paper, which writers do, and you do when you're putting the news mm-hmm. together. Mm-hmm. That took a long time. When I finally got Carol, right before she died 5 years ago, to sit down with me and let's go over, you know, her family stuff again, one more time, please, and let's look at the photographs. Then it took me about a year and a half to write the book after mm-hmm. that, because I promised her I would do it. But then when I wrote my memoir, when I sat down to write my memoir, it took me four months, because I'm sitting there writing and all this stuff's coming back. And then I Google to make sure that I'm getting dates and things mm-hmm. right, or people's names spelled right. And then I go out to Randall Library to my personal papers collection. So it's and people ask me this all the time, you know, how long does it take to write a book? Well, what kind of idea do you have? You got to have a starting point. If you don't know the subject, it's going to take you a long time.
Yeah. What do you have to do to end a day before you put your head down on the pillow?
Where'd you come up with that question?
I don't know. I asked somebody else that. Is there something you have to do every day before you lay your head down on the pillow?
I like a bowl of ice cream.
Why?
I do. Well, all my life I have, and I don't eat sweets particularly, but I do and thoroughly enjoy that bowl of ice cream. And one thing I always do is I turn off my computer because it's usually on, right? Or I turn off channel 6.
There you go. Should be the last thing you see before you go to bed. The first thing you see in the morning. John Evans and Francis Weller at night, Kim Ratcliffe and Bob Bonner in the morning. When all is said and done, how do you want people to remember Wilbur Jones?
For the fact that World War II history in the state of North Carolina was preserved, and other history, because I'm broader than just World War II. That's how I would like to be remembered, that the history was preserved. And if it's preserved, it will never be forgotten. It will always be there, whether it's a monument or a certificate or a piece of legislation. Do you hear me, Senator Stillis Burr and Congressman Rouser? We're getting closer to that, by
the way.
Will that
be your proudest day when Wilmington is honored as an American World War II city?
Yes.
Without a doubt?
Yes.
Why?
Not only have I worked on it every day for 10 years when I started this project, it's the personal and professional satisfaction of doing this in my hometown, because when we began this conversation, you asked me about when we entered the war in Pearl Harbor, and when I was talking about it, it's been on my mind constantly. And that's what I... The proudest achievement, and I say this in my memoir prologue, the proudest thing I've ever done is with Carol, my wife, my late wife, raising my granddaughter. And what she has turned out to be a wonderful mother. She's given me two great grandchildren, a school teacher in Wake County, married to a wonderful guy. But other than that, I want to see the president sign the legislation that makes Wilmington an American World War II city.
You know, I've told you, and I will continue to tell you, how much I respect you, how much I respect your work, and I'm glad you crafted 45 minutes out of your busy day here today to join me and be a part of this interview. History is alive in this city, and you're one of the main drivers of it.
John, thank you. And I'm gonna come right back at you and say that you are a pillar of this community in more ways than just the fact that your face is on television. And the things that you do to not only MC various events around town, but you are a serious figure that helps to keep this community together. And I don't want to see you retire, because for one thing, Aunt Aru told me to tell you that she thinks that you are the best dressed. I know you, as long as you're not wearing shorts you and bow ties, you are the best dressed male anchor on television anywhere. You really are. And I want to know, I've got a question for you, sir.
You know exactly what I'm going to say. It's my wife, Sheila, does that.
Well,
you know that.
Sheila is smart, but I want to know where Sheila gets your clothes, because I know that I can't afford them.
Wilbur, thank you. It's always a pleasure to spend time with you.
Thank you so much.
Wilbur Jones' memoir should be published soon, giving us all a chance to enjoy his life and his experiences. Until then, he's going to continue that push to bring that special designation to Wilmington, American World War II Heritage City. If you want to read about Wilbur Jones' history and his books, go to wilburjones.com. Next week, fresh off taking his Clemson Tigers to the NCAA Sweet 16, Coach Brad Brownell will join us, looking back at his time coaching at UNC Wilmington and the decision 12 years ago to move on.
We just had some administrative changes and some differences, and it was unfortunate that things weren't the way that I would have liked them to be, and I hated the way that I left. But looking back on it, I think it was probably one of the gutsiest decisions I've ever made and smartest decisions I made at the time. It still doesn't mean it doesn't hurt. We still come to Wilmington all the time because it's still a special place in my family's heart. My daughters are both born there. My wife's parents still live there. We have unbelievable group of friends that still live there, and it's a wonderful place. And I still want to see UNCW always do well.
That's head coach Brad Brownell next week right here on our podcast. If you know someone who you think would be a good interview for an upcoming episode, please let me know about it. Send me an email. The address is jevans@wect.com. And I'm asking you to please subscribe to our podcast as well. The more subscribers we have, the higher our recommendation will be on the platforms like Apple Podcasts, Google Play, and iHeartRadio. And if you send me a rating or a review to let me know what you thought of this interview or any of the others that we've done so far, and we pick your rating or review at random, you could be the lucky listener. We send a brand new WECT travel mug. I'm John Evans. Thanks for joining us for this week's episode of One on One.